Deshpande ji, we are back to Wisdom Quotes from Savitri after a gap of almost 20 days. We are today on to line number 90. It says, "Man can accept his fate, comma, he can refuse." Can you detail this line, please, in terms of, give us an explanation?
Yeah, this is a wisdom quote in our book number 90. It is a single line quotation and it appears in the context of the reply Narad is giving to Ashwapati's query. In fact, it is Ashwapati who had prompted Narad to bring out some deeper truth regarding the riddle of this world, the mechanism by which things run here. We have the soul of man, we have nature, we have the transcendental elements working in this creation, and there is a constant interplay of all these elements in the working of man's destiny here. In fact, there is a difference between destiny and fate. In a certain sense, destiny is something which is fixed, but fate is subject to the working of universal forces as well as the responses of an individual in the case of fate. Therefore, you immediately see that man can accept his fate, he can refuse his fate. There is something in him which gives him a choice. The element of choice is there. Fate and free will, fixed fate and free will, has been a subject of debate over centuries, centuries and centuries. In fact, some of these elements, some of these aspects are discussed in the Mahabharata also, in the Greek philosophy, in the Greek formulations, in Greek literature. This conflict is constantly presented in one form or the other. Milton, in his Paradise Lost, brings out the issue of fixed fate and free will. For him, the problem is in the context of something which was not supposed to be done having been done. The forbidden fruit was not to be tasted, eaten. But it was. By what circumstances, in what manner, those are matters of detail. Now the question which arises here is whether it was fated that the forbidden fruit will be eaten. So, it may appear to a logical mind that what was done by the first parents, as they say, was something in the nature of an act of disobedience. Was disobedience foreseen? Was that given a free choice? That is the question. Well, as far as the aspect of disobedience being foreseen is concerned, yes, it was foreseen. Now, at that point of time, the responsibility lies on the person concerned. He has a choice whether to accept the injunction or to reject it. The consequences are altogether different in both the cases. In the case of Adam Eve story, Although they were told not to eat the forbidden fruit, it was perhaps in the back of mind of whomsoever to call the creator that they must eat the forbidden fruit. And therefore, the things got arranged in such a way that it was done. It was done. In other words, to a large extent, Adam had no free choice. He could not have but eaten the forbidden fruit. Because if you see, or if you kind of rationalize the whole sequence, if you had to move onward, forward in the march of evolution, in the march of creation, that fall was necessary. And that fall could not have happened without this. So, although the choice is there, yet there is a kind of an imposition also to a large extent. I will give another example. On the battlefield of Kurukshetra, Arjuna was told to lift up his bow and arrow and kill the enemy. He was told. But at the same time, he had a free choice. He could have exercised his free will and not done what he was supposed to do. And the consequences of the war would have been different. So, at that moment of time, what should have Arjuna done? Should have lifted up the bow or not? He was persuaded to do that. He was coaxed to do that. He had to. He had some kind of a confidence in his mentor, and therefore he lifted the bow and did what he had to do. You see, in that sense, he was persuaded. He was forced to do that thing. You see, now in Hamlet, we have got a very beautiful statement. Our destiny does not lie in the stars. It is fixed. It is what we create. We produce the destiny. In fact, the Mahabharata also says that fate does not become effective without human action. Fate is helpless unless human action is carried out. So in that sense, as if everything gets focused in persuading man to do those things, he must do that kind of a thing. But let me give you another example at a different level. In Macbeth, the wizard, the witch told him, you will become the king. You go and kill the king, he was told by the witch. And this man accepted that thing. Now there, it was not the question of he being persuaded. It was a question of lack of judgment on his part, on his discernment. And therefore, the action there, the responsibility of that action lies on him, on Macbeth, and not on other circumstances. In the case of Arjuna, it does not lie on Arjuna. In the case of Adam, it did not lie so much on him. It was planned in a different manner, at a different table altogether, you see. And therefore, things had happened. Because, see, in the case of the Kurukshetra war, Arjuna was told to fight. And he was also told, look, all these people, I have already killed them. Be now just the instrument, nimitta matra, be the cause of killing them on the battlefield. Now, in other words, what Krishna had achieved already in the occult world could not have materialized without this action of his instrument. He had no free choice in that sense, and using his own nature, his own argument, his manner of working and all that thing, Krishna persuaded him to do what he had to do. See, understand? So man can accept, man can refuse. In fact, the context is, Ashwapati says to Narada, this is a world, it is a haunt of ignorance, it is a home of pain, this world is a home of pain, it is a haunt of ignorance. Does it mean that the spirit of this world is governed by external matters, manners? Is spirit subject to other forces? That is his basic question, Ashwapati's. And in response to that, Narad tells him, what is fate after all? Fate is truth worked out in the course of its operation. Now that is something which is exceptional and also meant for exceptional people. People who are destined to do certain things in a certain manner for certain purposes. For them, in that sense, there is really no choice. In the case of Savitri also here, it is in the context of Savitri. Savitri was very firm in her decision to marry Mr. Satyavan, and nobody could budge him. And Narada had told them that Satyavan must die 1 year after the marriage. Now, that must die is a destiny. That destiny can be fulfilled only if Savitri sticks to her decision. At that point, Savitri has an element of choice whether to marry him or not to marry him. But the destiny which is there, that is fixed. It so happens in the case of a person like Savitri, she has something deep in her which responds to the deeper truths of things. And she remains firm in that. Yes, I am firm in my decision, whatever be the consequence. I know how to meet death. I know how to change even the course of fate. That is the capacity she has already with her. And from that angle, we might say that it is not a choice which is being thrown at Savitri to marry or not to marry him. It is rather firming of her choice. Rather, it is the work from a certain occult angle which is being furthered by Narada. He comes here all the way to promote that work. What is required to be done in order to meet the hour of death? Satyavan must die, fix, nothing, nobody can change that. What is required is Savitri must prepare herself to meet that hour. Savitri must do yoga. Savitri must establish in her soul the divine power to meet the challenge. So it is that which is now really achieved by Narada, even by saying that he can refuse, he can accept fate. But here in this case, there is no question of budging from what Savitri must do.